Good morning. I will try again. All right, there we go. I think it was me, not y'all. Are we doing good this morning? Okay, perfect. All right. So it's wonderful to see everyone here this morning. And if you're visiting with us, thank you for choosing Riverside this morning to worship. We're so happy that you're here. So we've got quite a bit of announcements, so settle in for a minute. But first off, I want to welcome Reverend Chuck Reisinger for us today. Chuck began his ministry in 1976 as an evangelical Lutheran deacon. In 1999, he was called with his wife to a 3.5-year missionary journey. And then serving as a supply pastor until his first retirement, he and his wife moved to Brevard County in 2009, and then in 2010, he was called again to serve at a church for a supply pastor for a year. Before enjoying a year off, so kind of a semi-retirement, right? Chuck was then called to be the associate pastor in 2012, and for 5 years, he faithfully served his church until he said, well, what he calls his final retirement, except God had other plans. As he always does, right? In 2018, God called Chuck to serve as a visitation pastor at Eastminster Presbyterian, where he continues to serve in his almost 48 years of Christian service. So we want to welcome Reverend Chuck Reisinger this morning. Thank you so much for being here and sharing your message with us. So, thank you. So I'm sure you all saw when you came in, there's a big red bus in the parking lot. That obviously is that One Blood bus. And just so you know, if you didn't already, just one pint of blood can save up to 3 lives. So we would definitely help if, you know, you want to go out there and donate, we definitely would have you do that. They're here until 1:00 today. And if you decide to walk out in the middle of service, we're just going to assume that you're donating blood and that it doesn't have anything to do with Reverend Chuck this morning, okay? So please go out and donate. You can sneak in, sneak out. You'll get a cool bandage, and they might give you a free gift. So definitely go donate today. Just kind of following up from last Sunday, we had our Blues Brothers concert. It was amazing. It was so much fun. We had people dancing in the aisles, dancing in the pews. They had people up here on stage dancing. It was amazing. There were over 335 tickets sold, and that 46 of those were at the door, so just having people walk in. We had over $700 in just pure donations during the concert. And then after expenses, Riverside will be able to donate $2,300 to the I Am a Freedom Fighter organization to help end human trafficking. So amazing, amazing job. In addition, I Am a Freedom Fighter was here, and they had merchandise like t-shirts and cups and koozies and things like that that they sold. They sold over $730 in merchandise. So that goes directly back to their organization and exceeded all of our expectations. So again, thank you to you, thank you to the community for your generosity as we took that huge step to help end human trafficking. So thank you. A few more things. So next Saturday, which is October 26th from 4 to 6, we have our Trunk or Treat event. Some of you have already handed me candy this morning, so I appreciate that. But make sure that you, if you have donations of candy, that you can bring them to the church office this week. If you want to sign up, we need more cars. We need more people. We also need volunteers to hang out and hand out waters and hot dogs. So those will be free to anybody that attends the event. So we just need people and we need bodies. And so if you don't want to decorate a trunk, that's totally fine. Bring a lawn chair, come hang out with us so that we can serve the children and grandchildren of our community. If you have any questions or you want to sign up, like I said, see Anda and she can get you set on the right path. All right. Just a reminder about our first Tuesday dinner for November. It won't be November. It'll be October 29th. The first Tuesday in November is November 5th, which we all know is a very important date for elections. And because our fellowship hall is used as a polling station, we won't be able to have that on the 5th. So remember, Tuesday, October 29th is going to be our first Tuesday dinner for November, which is next Tuesday, not this coming Tuesday. The other thing is our second annual Thanksgiving dinner, which is held on Thanksgiving Day. We still need some volunteers, so we need volunteers to help organize, help cook, help bring in decorations and set up, break down, all of that good stuff. So if you are able to help with that, that would be wonderful. We would really appreciate it. And even if you're not going to be here on Thanksgiving Day, there are things that can be done beforehand, like decorating and organizing and setting up. And then those of us that will be here on Thanksgiving, we can help break down and that kind of stuff. But if you'll see Terry Beeler, or call the church office if you can help out with that, that would be wonderful. Thank you. The Space Coast Mopar Club Car Show, is going to be November 9th, so that's going to be on a Saturday. So we want to make sure that you know that it's a free event, and if you know anybody that wants to show a car, send them our way, okay? It's a free event to the community and to us, but any entry fees for a car, 100% of those proceeds are going to go to the Children's Hunger Project. And we all know how close of an organization that is to our hearts here at Riverside. Again, so November 9th from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. A couple other things. So there, Sunday, Carmen Torman, our friend and pastor that filled in, she is being ordained. So she has passed everything in her seminary school, and she is ready to take on a church herself. So she is being ordained as the minister, and her ordination service is today at 2:30 at the Presbytery Church of the Lakes in Orlando. So it's a little west of Orlando, but I'm sure that she would love to see some familiar faces if you'd like to join her today. The Chris Carson Cruisers for Kids bike drive is happening as well. In the fellowship hall, there's a Christmas tree. So when you walk in, you'll see Thanksgiving decorations, and you'll see Christmas tree. The Christmas tree has some envelopes on it. It's decorated with bikes. If you take one of those envelopes, you can make a donation in any amount that you'd like, and you just drop that off into the church office, or you can put it in the collection plate on Sunday. That'll be going on until December 1st, when we will go out and buy bikes for that drive. If you write a check, just make sure you write bikes in the memo line so we know where that money is supposed to go. A couple other things. I know I told y'all lots today. We're going to start collecting food items again for the Children's Hunger Project. And there will be an email that goes out through Riverside Net this week with those items that we will collect. Y'all know them. We've been doing this for a while. You know exactly what to bring. But start collecting those. We want to make sure that we have that food moving into kind of the winter months and then also into the first couple spring months when the kids come back to school. So again, that's going to start soon, but more information will come out this week. And then obviously, we are a very busy church family, and we want to make sure that we keep you up to date on everything. So we have a Facebook account, our Facebook page, as well as an Instagram page. So if you like and follow us on those social media platforms, you can keep all of this scrolling through so that you can keep seeing what's going on here at Riverside. But again, I just wanted to welcome everyone this morning, and then let's prepare our hearts and minds for worship.
y'all please stand and worship with us? Remains, and I hope you sing it with us as Andre goes ahead and starts with the intro here. Higher than the mountains that I face, stronger than the power of the grave, constant through the trials and the change, one thing remains, one thing remains. Your love never fails and never gives up and never runs out on me. Your love never fails and never gives up and never runs out on me. Your love never fails and never gives up and never runs out on me. Satisfies my soul, and I never ever have to be alone. This one thing remains, one thing remains. Your love never fails and never gives up and never runs out on me. Your love never fails and never gives up and never runs out on me. Your love never fails and never gives up and never runs out on me. In death, in life, I'm confident and covered by the power of your great love. My debt is paid, there's nothing that can separate the of your great love. In death, in life, I'm confident and covered by the power of your great love. My debt is paid, there's nothing that can separate from your great love. Your love never fails and never gives up and never runs out on me. Never runs out on me. Your love never fails and never gives up and never runs out on me.
Good morning. Would you please join us with the prayer of confession, followed by the Lord's Prayer, and then a silent moment of confession. Sometimes, God, we forget people, or we toss them aside, the difficult ones, the needy ones, the ones that are hard to spend time with, the ones who confront us. Sometimes when we do, worry about it. We are in such desperate need of your forgiveness. We need to be forgiven for our separation from you, for our mistakes, for mistaking what the world values with what you value. Help us to be better and to see more clearly and to care more thoroughly. This name we pray as we've been taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. A moment of silent confession. Amen. Friends, you can believe and trust because of our Lord Jesus Christ that your sins are forgiven. Now, time to pass the peace. Let's pass to everyone that is with us and those watching online. So, thank you. Peace to all. And also with you. Thank you, Pastor Chuck. So kids and youth, fusion youth, come on down, please. Yes, fashion.
You've been to church for any length of time. You've heard it a dozen, maybe more times. I probably preached on it 20 times in 48 years. And, you know, you think, well, what else can you say about that? And what God told me the last couple of weeks was, I'm tired. See, Jesus left Jerusalem and went to Sychar in Samaria. And it's a six-hour walk. They didn't have Uber camels or Uber donkeys or even Uber chariots at the time. So they had to walk. Okay. So 6 hours later, when they arrive in Sychar, Jesus told his disciples, get out of here, go get us some food. And he went and sat at the well. And he said, I'm weary. Some scriptures say I'm tired. And I was thinking about that. I've been tired. Have you been tired? I mean, I'm hurricane tired. Holy cow. Two in a row? The dilemma with that is the media, on all the channels, 3 days before the storm decides that's all they're going to show us. So you get the up to the second minute to get so wrapped up in this and so scared, you don't know whether to fight, run, you don't know what to do. I had a woman in my church, 18, 19 miles down the road from here, that loved to watch that. She couldn't take her eyes off of it, and she got so scared the night before the storm, she jumped in her car and drove to Georgia. We didn't lose a leaf on our tree, but she got so scared because of the media, okay? That's what happens when we get overloaded, doesn't it? We get tired. We're getting bombarded with political stuff. My phone, I bet you, gets 300 a day. Emails, texts. Are you still voting for me? No. Jesus goes to the well. He's tired. He's weary. The scripture doesn't tell us anything more than that. What's tiredness to you? She would prefer to sleep in bed all day. That's what tiredness is. Staying in your bed. Can I come to your house? Sounds to me like a nice way to spend the day, doesn't it?
If you come to my house, they're going to get you. Because I have to do stuff.
You have to do stuff. Doesn't matter, right? Has to go to school, has to do homework, has to get tired, right? We all get tired. Sometimes we get tired of being tired. Sometimes the tired seems to follow us like this cloud. Jesus was tired, but I think he was more than just tired with his feet. I think there was something going on in here too, and we're going to talk about that a little bit later. So when we talk about the heart, there's a different kind of tired that happens in the heart, doesn't it? You know, life changes as we grow older. What you did when you were in elementary school doesn't match to what you're going through now, does it? You're growing up, you're getting older, you're learning more things. And then you're finally realizing it's pretty scary out there because mom and dad aren't there to help you in the first few grades of school, right? Yeah. Well, we're going to talk about that, and we're all going to talk about that together. Would you pray with me? Lord, we're so grateful that we have an opportunity to share the message with at least one, because we're two or more than gathered. You are with us, Lord, and we are excited to be here this morning. Please be with those that are tired, lonely, weak, afraid, struggling, those in our community that just can't seem to get out of their way. For Lord, you are the great rock. You are our redeemer. You are the great I am. You are the one that is going to lead us forward. So we put our trust in you. We put our love with you. We put our grace with you. We put our families and our friends with you. Teach us, O Lord, that we might know you in a mighty, mighty way. Thank you, Lord. In your holy name I pray. Amen. Thank you for coming down. I didn't pick the songs. That's one of my favorite. Thank you. And you know what? The band could have played that too. You know that. That would have brought a real new depth to that song. Joyful, joyful. Especially in the guitar, right? Get out your purses. Clean out your wallet. Open up your pockets. It's time for the offering. Will the ushers please come forward?
Same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Yes, I will put you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I your name. Oh yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh yes, I will. I count on one thing, the same God that never fails will not fail me. Won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. taking all things out. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh, yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy in all my days. Oh, yes, I will.
Let us pray. Oh Lord, we come to you this day in this place, worshiping, glorifying you, being part of a family of Christians here at Riverside. Lord, we thank you for that. And we also want you to bless this bounty that we have collected today. May it serve you. May it bring you joy and peace. May it help the community. May it make Riverside richer. And may it be used to glorify you in everything that you are and you are and you say, Lord. We thank you for the offerings from the company of people that are here, Lord, and we ask you to continue to be a part of this ministry here at Riverside. In Jesus' name, amen.
The Old Testament reading this morning is Isaiah 40, verses 28 through 31. Do you not know, have you not heard? The everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, does not become weary or tired. His understanding is inscrutable. He gives strength to the weary, and to him who lacks might, he increases power. Though youths grow weary and tired, and vigorous young men stumble badly, yet those who wait for the Lord will gain new strength. They will mount up with wings like eagles. They will run and not get tired. They will walk and not become weary. Thanks be to God.
In the darkest hour, when I cannot breathe, fear is on my chest, the weight of the world on me. Everything is crashing down, everything I had known, when I wonder if I'm all alone. I remember, you have always been faithful to me. I remember, even when my own eyes could not see, you were there. Always there. I will lift my eyes, even in the pain. Above all the lies, I know you can make a way. giants fall. I have seen mountains move. I have seen waters part because of you.
You know, I'm really, I'm wonderfully today. I didn't know God sent a cherub to sing that. Would you join me in prayer? Lord, we don't know what you know. We see the world and our own life with all too human eyes. Sometimes we miss the wilder perspective, Lord. But see, you see all things, and you know your ultimate purpose. So guide our steps, our thoughts, our decisions, and our life, so that it all points to you and your plan, Lord. Let us not fear making a decision, for we know that if it's not your will, we can trust that you'll speak the truth into us and our life and steer us back on track, Lord. So guide us today and every day, Lord, helping us remember with every breath we take that our job is to align with you. Oh, Lord, it's a busy time. It's a hectic rushing and so many priorities clamoring to take our attention. Lord, help us to push aside all the other voices in our culture competing for our heart and mind. Instead, let the truth of the great I am wash over us. Help us to cling to you as the only source and rescue and refuge. Lord, help us to know every ounce of our being that you are the Lord and Savior, the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning and the end. You're the God of the universe. You're the God of all creation. Thank you for the life you put in us. And we're so thankful for the love we share today in this place. Even though sometimes it may be difficult, Lord, help us to honor that love with a generous, compassionate heart. Help us to love not only ourselves and those in our inner circle, but family, friends, neighbors, and also those who despise us and those who push us away. Help us to love, for you eclipsed all of that so that the love that we can exhibit shines so extravagantly that people can look at us and know that we belong to you. Forgive those who hate or wrong us. Let our life inspire their path to you so we can all share in your kingdom forever. Lord, you are designed. You are a rock. You are a redeemer. And we are yours. I say this prayer in the name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Again, I'm Pastor Chuck Reisinger, and I'm 19 miles down the street, Eastminster Presbyterian Church. They loaned me out. Actually, they kicked me out, so I'm here for today. And it's a privilege to be here, fellow Presbyterians. But you know the one thing I've learned about being Presbyterian? Very few of us are cradle Presbyterian. It's interesting that when couples marry, one could be a Catholic and the other's a Baptist, and they say, well, I don't want to be a Catholic and I don't want to be Baptist. Let's be a Presbyterian. Right? Am I wrong? I find it to be joyful that in spite of the differences we have in community, sometimes within denominations, that we all seek to understand the same God. And that is the God that gives us and renews us and rejoices with us each and every day of our lives. Today, I'm covering, like I say, a gospel from the book of John. And this, of course, we know that John was one of Jesus' favorite disciples. And he writes in here about the journey out of Jerusalem. Listen to his words. Now, I'm going to read to you from the New King James. I'm sorry. Put up with me, okay? The words will be up there. Wrong page. Therefore, when the Lord knew that the Pharisees had heard that Jesus made and baptized more disciples than John, though Jesus himself did not baptize, but his disciples, he left Judea and departed again to Galilee. But he needed to go through Samaria. So he came to a city of Samaria, which is called Sychar, near the plot of ground that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. Now Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, therefore, being weary from his journey, sat by the well. It was about the sixth hour. A woman of Samaria came to draw water, and Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink." For his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. Then the woman of Samaria said to him, "How is it that you, being a Jew, ask a drink from me, a Samaritan woman? For Jews have no dealings with Samaritans." Jesus answered, and he said to her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is who says to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." The woman to him, "Sir, you have nothing to draw from, and the well is deep. Where then are you going to get this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us this well and drank from it himself, as well as his sons and his livestock?" Jesus answered and said to her, "Whoever drinks of this water will thirst again. But whoever drinks of the water that I shall give him will never thirst, for the water that I shall give him will come up from a fountain of water springing up into everlasting life. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. There's so much to talk about in that passage, isn't there? It's just full of who we are and what we strive to be, walking with Jesus. I was in seminary a long time ago. But in seminary, they say, you got to do the why, where, who, and what in your sermons, okay? So I've always said, okay, I'll do that, professor. So I'm going to tell you right now and get it out of the way. Why? Because Jesus was tired. Where? Sychar, Samaria. Who to talk to? Samaritan woman. And what? Asking for water. Now you know. Okay? Now you know. The rest of it, I don't know where I'm going with this. Jesus' disciples, does this camera move? It does? Good. He's going to have to move hard. Jesus and his disciples had been in Jerusalem, okay? Not the greatest experience. I mean, there was this thing about at the temple, and his tables got overturned, and there's some folks that weren't happy. And everywhere that Jesus went, the Pharisees had spies in the crowd. Every single moment that he was anywhere talking to anybody, there were spies listening and reporting back to the Pharisees. It was exhausting. So knowing that he was not welcome, he wanted to go home. He wanted to go see some family. He wanted to get some fresh fish. I put that in there. It's not true. So he and his disciples left, it says, about 6 in the morning. And they walked until noontime, which is 6 hours. And do you notice that in verse, I think it was 7, that he told his disciples, head into town and get us some food? Well, aren't you coming, Lord? I put that in there too. No, I'm going to sit by the well. If you were a Jew at Jesus' time and you wanted to go to Galilee, you would leave Jerusalem, cross the River Jordan, go through Perea and Decapolis, and then out and about into Galilee. It's a 6-day journey. You know how to get there otherwise? The straight journey through Samaria. I contend that's the divine route. How many times in your life have you gone around this way when you just should have gone straight? I remember times before, what's in my pocket here? This device. I had to learn to read a map. And so when we traveled and anywhere we went, we had maps. And my wife had the map and she could tell me where to go, but I was a male. Sometimes I went roundabout because I didn't listen to the map reader. Have you ever done that? Guys, don't admit it. Don't admit it. I know you have. Jesus took a route that a Jewish rabbi would never go. What do we know about that? I want to tell you that Jesus was about his Father's work. It wasn't about who he was incarnate, God, but about doing his Father's work. And he knew that his Father told him to go the divine way, the straight way, and that he needed to rest and stop at Jacob's well. I don't know if he knew why, but I knew he had to be there. I don't know how long he was sitting there by himself, praying or whatever, before the woman came out to get the water. Did you know she almost turned around? That's not in there either. Because she was an unclean Samaritan woman. Even in Samaria, she was shunned. She had to go out when nobody came out in the heat of the day to get their water. In those times, you got water in the mornings and in the evenings. You didn't go out during the heat of the day to get water at the well. Yet this woman came to the well for water. The scripture says that she came up to the well and saw him there, and Jesus said, "Woman, give me a drink." If I ever said woman to my mom, "Give me a drink," well, these teeth have been replaced. But our Lord said, "Woman, give me a drink." Was he thirsty? Probably. I mean, that was a long walk. Was that his intent, to get water from her? I don't know. But I do know that Jesus was present for her and only her. Only her. And she did everything she could to stay away from him. But Jesus insisted, "Give me a drink." "Well, you don't have anything. The well's deep." "Give me a drink." "Well, I don't know you. It is not proper." "Give me a drink. Give me a drink." "Well, I guess I could do that." And Jesus said to her, "If you knew who I was and am, not only would you give me a drink, but I would give you living water." Does Jesus make this stuff up? It's just in Scripture that he's going to have living water? You know, we got like 80% of the Old Testament is in the New Testament. Jesus was fulfilling the what? The law. When he came. You know, there were 41 leaders in the Old Testament of Israel. Jewish Israel. 41. And God appointed each and every one of those. And after number 40, he said, "Crap, I can't do that. Oh, no, I'm going to send my son. He'll get them right. He'll let them know." Did they follow him? Yeah, most of the folks did, like you and I. But the ones who were in charge, the churchy ones, not so much. Why? Because they stepped on their toes, got into their pockets, took away some of their gilded lining of all of their clothes with gold. But he's at the well. He just walked 6 hours. You're not understanding this, I don't think. I was in the military. I was going to college when Uncle Sam said, a letter in the mail, he said, "You are such a nice guy, I want you." "Well, I'm taking college classes. I'm going to get out of this." "No, I was taking 12 hours. You had to have 15. So Uncle Sam just loved me and took me exactly as I was and then turned me into something I really never knew I would be. And you know, I can remember going through training and the ones that was the worst were knights. If you guys were ever in the service or women, our knight training was the toughest because we didn't have all the devices you have today to see out into the darkness. We only had these. And it was a scary time. And I can remember my first training exercise with live fire. And we were put into our foxholes and told to stay there and rest. And if you can, catch a few hours of sleep. They're nuts. I'm 23 years old in a foxhole, looking out over there saying, what the heck is going on here? But then what you don't know when you're in a foxhole is it stinks because it smells really earthy. And you're not the only person that's been in that foxhole in the last few days. You don't know what's been going on in that foxhole. That's kind of like Jesus at the well. He'd been walking 6 hours. Have you ever watched The Chosen on TV, the show? You know, he just had the one garb. Wonder how that was. So the woman at the well says, okay, I'll give you some water. But it goes much further than that. There's a thing called living water connected here that we have to understand what that is. I don't even know where I'm at. Hang on. I want to go. I got some scriptures in here that my brain doesn't fully process today. So let me see if I can find. Here they are. So the term living water, I did some research on that. And I found in the book of Joel, chapter 3, verse 18, Joel tells how a fountain will flow out of the Lord's house and will water the valley of the acacia trees. In Zechariah 14:8, there's a description. It's of living water flowing out from Jerusalem on the day of the Lord. One branch flows to the Mediterranean, and the other branch flows to the Dead Sea. In Ezekiel's vision, vegetation springs up along the banks of the river, and the water in the Dead Sea is made fresh and teems with fish. In John's revelation, chapter 22, verse 1, he sees a vision of the river of water of life, which flows from the throne of God and the Lamb through the midst of the New Jerusalem, providing sustenance for the tree of life whose leaves are for the healing of the nations. Living water is never stagnant. A well somehow has to have water in that well year round, whether it comes from an underground stream or a trickle from over here, it's got to have water. Living water is never stagnant. The Dead Sea is not living water. It's high content of salt. Do you know the Jordan River runs all the way down and into the Dead Sea, and yet that sea is dead? Have you ever swam in the ocean out here? I mean, you live right down the street. What's it like to float in the ocean or to float in a pool in your house? In fresh water, I sink like a rock. In salt water, I can float. What's up with that? In the Dead Sea, it's so salty that anybody can float. But when you get out, you got to wash down because there's salt all over you. But it's called a spa over there. They enjoy that. Ezekiel says that the water's going to flow, living water, and the Dead Sea is going to come alive. How do we look at living water today? There is only one thing that living water can produce in you and I, in this place, on this day, at this hour, and that's the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is what makes you and I Christ followers. Sometimes we follow Christ because we know in our heart we need to, and we have yet to experience that gift that Jesus promised in the spirit of our hearts and our lives. For if we were to continue without that Holy Spirit, the church would no longer be alive. Because, see, that's living water for you and I. We need that. Every church needs that. Every Christian needs that. We are part of the great I Am. I am the gate. If you come through me, you've got to leave from me. No one else is welcome. I am the true vine. When you come to me, I will feed you living bread. I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am the great I Am, says he. That's all we need to know. This scripture tells us all kinds of things, and today I wrote down all kinds of stuff which I don't even remember. Because, see, the Holy Spirit guides as a pastor who's here and who here needs to hear this. And sometimes I don't even know what I'm saying, but God does. And so today I want to thank you for welcoming me here in this beautiful place. I want to thank the musicians and the singers and everyone who has been gracious to me today to invite me here to worship with you and to be part of you. I want to thank the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ that he got you out of bed this morning and brought you here. Because you didn't have to. You could have stayed at home and watched it on that. Jesus said, I am the living water. I will give you life to the fullest. And if you haven't accepted life to the fullest yet, you're missing out on the living water. Ezekiel said, the Dead Sea is dead, and yet it will teem with life and fishes. Are you ready to teem with life and fish? Well, let's go fishing for something. Jesus said that I am the resurrection and the life. Anyone who comes can come through me, and I will bring them rest. Are you tired? Are you overwhelmed? Are you feeling depressed, anxious, weak? Jesus says, I'm the living water. Have you called on me today, or did you go around this way and forget to go the divine way and talk to me? You know, we teach you that prayer is from here to there, up and down, up and down, and up and down, up and down, up and down, up and down. But the problem is, I get hung up with, Lord, I would love a Ferrari. My up and down sometimes gets a little crazy. And the one thing we forget about that is it's more than an up and down to the cross. For you see, that's the up and down that you and I normally pray to. But when you start mixing that with love, hope, forgiveness, responsibility, caring, holding, loving, being, your prayers take on a different meaning. Your prayers take on living water. I don't know what's next. Wait a minute. Let me quickly look at this. Okay. We have a sermon. hymn. Okay, we got a hymn, 546, and God stand, 546. You notice I didn't say amen? You get to do that when you leave these doors today. You are the amen that's going out there. We are just having fun. There's where the work begins, out those doors. So when you leave here, when you go outside, I want to hear amen, okay? I want to hear it. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you. The Lord look upon you with gracious and love and peace and mercy. The Lord bring his countenance to you. And we do that in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Oh, well, darn it, it's supposed to be out there.
Open up the heavens. We want to see you open up the floodgates. A mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our. Open up the heavens. We want to see you open up the floodgates. A mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our prayer. Heavens, we want to see you open up the floodgates. The mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our. Open up the heavens, we want to see you open up the floodgates. The mighty river flowing from your heart.